unidos todos como hermanos.
In the slums of El Salvador, a Jesuit priest says he supports the guerrillas' cause. In the center of the town, the Pope says that's wrong. Priests, he proclaims, must not involve themselves in politics. Tonight, the Pope is back home. After a Central American trip through those countries where violence so often puts the spotlight on the role played by the Roman Catholic Church. And none more so than El Salvador.
The Pope's tour has stirred the argument and stirred consciences in the political fight between the United States and its friends, still usually in government, and the Marxist guerrillas, usually encouraged by Cuba and the East. And inside the Catholic Church, between the priests who keep to traditional ideas against violence and disruption, and the priests who think that what the Pope called in El Salvador, the anguish, the pain, and the weariness, must be gone through to end what he also called indifference, injustice, and complacency. Julian Mannion watched the Pope through the eyes of the people of El Salvador.
In northern El Salvador, a church that bears witness to this apparently endless war. A vicious gun battle erupted in the small town of Tejutla 10 days before the Pope's visit. Tejutla had a garrison of 200 soldiers, but when the guerrillas attacked, 8 men died and the rest fled into the bush. Today the town is a no man's land. The army has abandoned it. The guerrillas come only at night. The people of Tejutla now have no government and no law, but in this deeply Catholic country, they still have their church. The village priest is Father Valerio Yekeli, an old-fashioned man who tries to avoid politics and give spiritual support to his people. After 35 years in this village, he was selected last week to play a special part in John Paul's Mass in the capital. For the priest, it was confirmation that the church knew of the dark times that Tejutla is living through.
These people used to live quietly in their homes. They are frightened by these encounters between armed forces. They consequently look for refuge and safety. Now they find they are no safer here. So they are looking for somewhere else to save their lives. Sometimes people have left their homes in the villages where they had everything they needed. They raised animals, raised chickens, everything. And now, in search of refuge in the center, they're having to pay rent and more for food. It's a time of great sorrow.
The Pope's arrival in El Salvador was as tumultuous as the crisis that the Catholic Church now faces in that country. A crisis about the Church's role in this vicious civil war. An estimated 500,000 people came to hear the Pope. It was a clear demonstration of the power that the church still wields in El Salvador. Surrounding the Pope, clergymen like Father Yekeli from the different war-torn areas of El Salvador. All of them heard the Pope deliver a heartfelt condemnation of the violence. In his words, how many more children must be orphaned? But the Pope stopped short of directly attacking the heavily guarded leaders of the government, a government that, according to its critics, has one of the worst human rights records in the world. Those critics include a Jesuit listening on the fringes of the crowd. John Cortina is one of El Salvador's rebel priests.
I am not preaching anything about Marxism or revolution.
My impression is that the preaching is really the gospel. Christ was called a rebel, and they will call them, and they will call us rebels too.
Jan Cortina is a Spanish priest who has risked death many times. He works with villagers and refugees and openly encourages them to fight for social justice.
They have to break with their families. Women and children are in one side. The man could be dead. So many dead people, so much blood in this country during the last 3 years.
40,000 people have died in the last 3 years in El Salvador. And still the war goes on, with each side trying to build up its forces. In the last year, the guerrillas have staged hit-and-run raids against a string of towns. Each time, the army gathers its strength to recapture the objective, and the population are exposed to the crossfire.
My impression is that when you talk upon violence in such a general way, violence deserves condemnation. But for me, always the point is, where is the first violence? We know also that violence calls on violence, but it's always the point to see where is the first violence. And my impression is that not enough stress is given to this first violence, which the poor and the oppressed have been suffering here for centuries.
The first violence, according to the rebel priests, has always been perpetrated by the wealthy elite who now live in heavily guarded houses in the outskirts of the capital, San Salvador. Until quite recently, only 14 families controlled the country's economy. Today, wealth and influence have spread outwards a little to include generals, officials, and a number of businessmen. These men argue that they are gradually liberalizing the country's economy while preventing El Salvador from turning into a communist dictatorship. Men like Johnny Maldonado are in no doubt that left-wing priests are among their most important enemies.
The Pope has a problem in Central America regarding the disobedience of these priests. Some of them, as in Nicaragua, they pretend and remain in power, you know, in the government level. Here, there are some who are still active, and they are the intelligentsia behind the leftist movement.
You really are accusing these Jesuits of support for the terrorists, as you call them, for the guerrillas, in this struggle here?
Oh, yes, definitely. We know that they are very much involved.
What should the Pope do about them, in your view?
It's very difficult because the ideology of this priest is based mostly in the theology of revolution, the theology of liberation, which, you know, has a lot of leftist tendencies.
Security is what counts above everything for men with wealth and power in El Salvador. Johnny Maldonado is head of the Private Enterprise Association and could at any moment be a target for left-wing terrorists. He has two bulletproof cars with sirens and special communication systems. To do business, he flits across the city from one fortress to another. This one is the Chamber of Commerce. For men like this, who have learned to live with violence, the opposition priests are among the people who are trying to take their country away from them.
I think that they are distorting the reality of the situation because, I mean, what they are preaching here is distribute everything to everybody and forget about production and forget about the generation of wealth. My contention is that in order to solve the social problems of the country, which we do have, economic problems, such as, for instance, and social ones, such as education, health, housing, income distribution, in order to be able to solve those problems, you have to be able to generate them, to generate wealth in order to distribute it better.
But in the barrios, the slums of San Salvador, it now seems to some Catholic priests that the redistribution of wealth is the very essence of the Bible's teaching.
todos como hermanos, recemos ahora la oración que Jesús nos enseñó. Padre nuestro que estás en el cielo, santificado sea tu nombre, venga tu reino, hágase tu voluntad en la tierra como en el cielo. Danos hoy nuestro pan.
But it doesn't just end with spiritual guidance and protection. Father Cortina believes that it is his mission to actively encourage his flock in the struggle for justice. He takes as his text the plight of the Israelites under Egyptian oppression. And on the war, he says that it can only be solved by dialogue and negotiation, words that mean the participation of the left in government. Father Cortina was plainly delighted by what the refugees said about the Pope's visit and their hopes for peace.
We don't understand that the Pope is coming here for any political position and advocating for a dialogue or not. We understand that he's going to be, this is a pastoral visit, and he's going to talk to the Catholics for peace, etc., etc. Now, regarding the dialogue, we don't think that the dialogue is the right word at this particular time. At this particular time, there is no chance between two opposing forces, one a minority such as the terrorist guerrillas and a larger force, which is the army, to dialogue from equal to equal position. What we have here in El Salvador is not a tie. There is no tie. I mean, we don't have the half of the country in the hands of the guerrilla fighters and half of the country in the hands of the terror, of the army. What we have is a stalemate. It's a totally disbalanced stalemate by which the army has not been able to crush the terrorist guerrilla fighters, but they are not growing. Meanwhile, the army is growing, and the popular support of the terrorists is non-existent. They do not have any support on the part of the population. So a dialogue under these conditions, why? What for? When do you ask for a dialogue? When you are winning or when you are losing?
The focus of the rebel priests' campaign for what they regard as a just peace is the Catholic University. The teaching staff here are led by Jesuits, most of them from the Basque part of Spain. They have turned their section of the university into what the right wing regards as a center of subversion. Jon Cortina is one of the lecturers. Asked whether, at the end of the day, they supported the cause of guerrilla movements like the FDR, their answer is a qualified yes.
I imagine that they do make mistakes also, and that they violate some of the teachings of Jesus in some of his acting. I think that if you consider what the poor people lived before and what they are trying to, the FDR, what he is trying to get for these people, which is a closer society with not so many differences, I imagine that that is closer to Christ, to Jesus' teachings.
And the university's top theologian, Jon Sobrino, says that their beliefs are based strictly on the teachings of the Bible.
In the last analysis, it comes to this. The gospel is subversive. There is no way around that. It is subversive. Read the Beatitudes and also what Jesus said to those, to the powerful, to the rich, to the wealthy. And if there were any doubt that the gospel is subversive, you have to watch only at what happened to Jesus of Nazareth. He was killed, he was assassinated, and his death was not an accident.
On the 24th of March, 1980, Romero was saying mass in this small chapel in San Salvador. A gunman had fired the shot from a car outside the chapel. When Pope John Paul prayed at Romero's tomb last Sunday, it was the most moving and at the same time most intriguing moment of his visit to El Salvador. The Archbishop's sacrifice clearly touched him, though for this deeply conservative and anti-communist Pope, there must still have been doubt about some of Romero's actions. Had he visited the National Assembly, the Pope would have had every right to be confused. For the Assembly President is none other than Roberto Dabuisson, the man widely accused of organizing Romero's murder. Dabuisson is a name that to many Salvadorians is synonymous with the death squads that have done so much to keep the right wing in power in this country. Dabuisson lives under tight security. Inside the barbed wire, the man that the last U.S. ambassador to El Salvador openly described as a psychopathic killer plays with his children and revels in his new career as a politician that followed his success in last year's elections. I asked him if he had indeed been responsible for Archbishop Romero's murder.
I wasn't even in the country when it happened. The first person who tried to involve me in it was the ambassador, Robert White. Ex-ambassador Robert White, because I opposed him. I even spoke critically of him to Mr. Carter at the Department of State because of the situation in Nicaragua. They wanted us to go through the same process. But in the last resort, he even did me a favor. My controversial image gave me added strength here in my own country. And the only thing that matters to me is what's said here among my own people, my family, not what a sick former ambassador may think.
Will you now try to break the cycle of violence which has gripped this country? Is there anything you can do? Can you call off the killers that are terrorizing this country?
There are no terrorists here on the right. We are the subject here of pro-Soviet aggression or Castro terrorism. But the people have already given their initial response. The people of El Salvador have said a clear no to this violence.
But the facts are that no fewer than 12 priests have died at the hands of the right-wing death squads. And in the most horrific incident in 1980, three American nuns and a lay worker were murdered by National Guardsmen. It's a crime that still embarrasses the government when it tries to secure American aid to continue the war. There's no doubting Jon Cortina's personal courage. He has been the target of four separate attempts on his life, two of them at his own house.
Our house has been machine gunned and bombed. They put, in 72 hours, 17 bombs. Only three exploded. If you consider the amount of priests, bishops, nuns, catechists, and people of the Christian communities who have been killed, you could call this church a persecuted church, a martyr church, and a church of, which is living like in the first times of Christianity, which has to carry on their activities, some of them, many of them, in a half-hidden way. I would call it a martyr church.
But Pope John Paul II does not see the role of the church in El Salvador in quite such fundamentalist terms. At the end of his visit, his chaotic motorcade took him to a school where he addressed priests and nuns on their duty during this terrible civil war. He told them that it was no part of a priest's job to get involved in partisan ideologies. Their mission, he said, was to reconcile the warring parties. It's the close relationship between some priests and the left-wing guerrillas that is at the root of the Pope's misgivings. For him, the leftist groups are suspect both because they may become totalitarian and because they are at present destructive. Can social justice be achieved with the rocket launcher and the gun? That is now the issue facing the church in El Salvador. The costs of the struggle have become all too plain. The army is unable to protect every power line and telegraph pole in the country, and the guerrillas, who have failed to win outright victory, have now settled down to an ugly war of attrition with the aim of cutting the country's sinews one by one. They have begun to destroy the country in order to liberate it. Right-wing leaders now claim that the rebel priests of El Salvador are worsening the country's crisis.
But I don't think that it is going to be solved preaching class struggle, killing, destruction, and also assassination. Because up to today, in the last 3 years, neither one of those problems that they are pretending to defend have been solved. On the contrary, the population of the Salvadorian this Salvadorian country have been deprived of electricity, food, crops, production, jobs, because of the preaching of these priests. Because they preach destruction, assassination, take the arms, kill. And that's not the solution.
But the priests who work with the poor and the refugees utterly reject the idea that they may in some way be contributing to the misery of El Salvador.
In my opinion, that we have to abandon some of the idols we have here, idols which can be the power, money, the wealth, commodities, and try to live like brethren. I think I am quite determined to go on this type of work and the work I am doing now, because I think that I have a commitment with God, which whose fulfillment is my commitment with the poor and with the oppressed people. And this way also will follow the, well, guidelines or the directions which has been given to us as churchmen of promotion of the faith and defense of justice.
Along with his mission of peace, the Pope came to Central America to try and curb the Church's involvement in revolutionary politics. But to those priests who believe in the so-called theology of liberation, the tortured countries of Central America offer the irresistible lure of self-sacrifice and even martyrdom. And that may in the end prove far more powerful than even an edict from Rome.